Meanwhile, the president's challenger was also in New York, also facing some difficult questions.
How do you stay in shape?
Do you eat something?
Do you have a routine? Do you
It's like Nerf Crossfire.
Welcome back to Crossfire. As both of our loyal viewers, of course, know, our show is all about left versus white, black versus white, paper versus plastic, Red Sox against the Yankees. That's why every day we have two guests with their own unique perspective on the news. But today, Crossfire is very different. We have just one guest. He's either the funniest smart guy on TV or the smartest funny man. We'll find out which in a minute. But he's certainly an Emmy Award winner, the host of Comedy Central's Daily Show, and the co-author of the new mega bestseller, America the Book, A Citizen's Guide to Inaction, at your bookstores everywhere. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Crossfire, John Stewart.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's very kind of you to say. Now what, can I say something very quickly? Why do we have to fight? The two of you, can't we just say something nice about John Kerry right now?
I like John. I care about John Kerry.
And something about President Bush.
He'll be unemployed soon. I failed the
test. I made the effort anyway.
No, actually, I knew Bush in Texas a little bit. And the truth is, he's actually a great guy. He's not a very good president, but he's actually a very good person. I don't think you should have to hate to oppose somebody, but it makes it easier.
Why do you argue? The two of you, why? I hate to see it.
We enjoy it.
Let me
ask you a question first.
All right.
Is John Kerry really the best? I mean, I think, you know, John Kerry's done a terrible
job. Is he the best?
Guy.
Like,
Lincoln
was good.
Is he the best the Democrats can do?
Is he the best the Democrats
can
do? Yeah,
this year.
I'd always thought in a democracy, and again, I don't know, I've only lived in this country, that there's a process, what they call them, primaries.
Right.
And they don't always go with the best, but they go with whoever won. So is he the best? According to the process.
Right, but of the nine guys running, who do you think was best? Do you think he was the best? The most impressive?
The most impressive?
Yeah.
I thought Al Sharpton was very impressive. I enjoyed his way of speaking. I think oftentimes the person that knows they can't win is allowed to speak the most freely, and because otherwise shows with titles such as Crossfire, or Hardball, or I'm gonna kick your ass, or we'll jump on it. In many ways, it's funny, you know, and I made a special effort to come on the show today because I have privately amongst my friends and also in occasional newspapers and television shows mentioned this show as being bad.
Mm-hmm.
I felt that that wasn't fair, and I should come here and tell you that I don't. It's not so much that it's bad as it's hurting America. So I wanted to
but
come here today
defense, let me,
and say...
Wait.
Here's just what I wanted to tell you guys.
Yeah.
Stop. Stop hurting America.
Okay, now...
And come work for us, because we, as the people...
How do you pay?
The people, not well.
Better than CNN, I'm sure.
But you can sleep at night. See, the thing is, we need your help. You're right now you're helping the politicians and the corporations, and we're left out there
to mow our lawns. You just said we're too rough on them when they make mistakes.
No, you're not too rough on them. You're part of their strategies. You're partisan, what do you call it, hacks.
Wait, John, let me tell you something valuable that I think we do that I'd like to see you
something
do.
Something valuable?
Yeah, no, it's
I would
nice
like
when,
to, I would
when
like
politicians,
to hear it.
And I'll tell you, when politicians come on,
yeah.
It's nice to get them to try and answer the question. And in order to do that, we try and ask them pointed questions. I want to contrast our questions with some questions you asked John Kerry.
If you want to compare your show to a comedy show, you're more than welcome to.
Here's the point.
If that's your goal...
No, it's not.
I would name for us. I'd aim for
here's
Seinfeld.
The problem.
That's
Kerry
a very good show.
Kerry won't come on this show. He will come on your show. Let me suggest why he wants to.
Well,
come
we
on
have
show.
Civilized discourse.
Well, here's an example of civilized discourse. Here are three of the questions you asked John.
Yeah.
You have a chance to interview the Democratic nominee. You ask him questions such as, quote, how are you holding up? Is it hard not to take the attacks personally?
Yeah.
Have you ever flip-flopped, et cetera, et cetera?
Yeah.
Didn't you feel like you got the chance to interview the guy? Why not ask him a real question instead of just suck up to him?
Yeah, how are you holding up is a real suck up. And I actually was giving him a hot stone massage.
It sounded that way.
As we were doing it.
It did.
You know, it's interesting to hear you talk about my responsibility to the, you know, I didn't realize that, and maybe this explains quite a bit.
No, the opportunity.
Is that the news organizations look to Comedy Central for their cues on integrity. So what I would suggest is, when you talk about you're holding politicians' feet to the fire, I think that's disingenuous. I think you're...
How are you holding up? I mean, come on.
No. I don't, but my role isn't, I don't
well, you
think.
You can ask him a real question, don't you think? Instead of saying, you know.
I don't think I have to. By the way, I also asked him, you know, were you in Cambodia? But I didn't really care. Because I don't care. Because I think
I
it's
tell.
Stupid.
Well,
but my point is this. Mm-hmm. If your idea of confronting me is that I don't ask hard-hitting enough news questions, we're in bad shape, fellas.
We're here to love you, not confront you.
No. But what I'm saying is this. I'm not. I'm here to confront you because we need help from the media, and they're hurting us. And it's now, the idea
if
is...
If the indictment is... Let me get this straight. If the indictment is, and I have seen you say this, that Crossfire reduces everything, as I said in the intro, to left, right, black, white.
Yes.
Well, it's because, see, we're a debate show. It's like saying the Weather Channel
reduces that'd be great.
To a storm.
I would love to see a debate show.
30 minutes in a 24-hour day where we have each side on as best
we can
get
them. That would be great.
And have them fight it out.
To do a debate would be great, but that's like saying pro wrestling is
John, a show about athletic competition. I think you're a good comedian. I think your lectures are boring. Let me ask you a question on the news.
Now, this is theater. I mean, it's obvious. How old are you?
35.
And you wear a bow tie.
Yeah, I do.
So this is...
No, I know.
So
you're right. No, let me just go. Now, come on.
And listen, I'm not suggesting that you're not a smart guy, because those are not easy to tie. But the
they're
thing
difficult.
Is that this, you're doing theater when you should be doing debate, which would be great.
Well, it's not honest.
What you do is not honest. What you do is partisan hackery. And I'll tell you why I know.
You and John Kerry on your show, and you sniff his throne, and you're accusing us of partisan hackery?
Absolutely.
You've got to be kidding, man.
You're on CNN. The show that leads into me is puppets making crank phone calls. What is wrong with you?
Well, I'm just saying, there's no reason for you, when you have this marvelous opportunity not to be the guy's butt boy, to go ahead and be his butt boy.
Yes,
God,
no.
It's embarrassing.
I was absolutely his butt boy. I was so far. You would not believe what he ate 2 weeks ago. You know, the interesting thing that I have is, you have a responsibility to the public discourse, and you fail miserably.
School, I think.
You need to go to one. The thing that I want to say is, when you have people on for just knee-jerk, reactionary talk...
Wait, I thought you were going to be funny. Come on, be funny.
No, I'm not going to be your monkey.
Go ahead.
I watch your show every day, and it kills me.
I can tell you love
it's so... Oh, it's so painful to watch. You know, because we need what you do. This is such a great opportunity you have here to actually get politicians off of their marketing and strategy. Yeah, it's someone who watches your show and cannot take it anymore. I just can't.
What's it like to have dinner with you? It must be excruciating. Do you like lecture people like this when you come over to their house and sit and lecture them and, you know, they're not doing the right thing, that they're missing their opportunities, evading their responsibilities?
If I think they are.
Look, I wouldn't want to eat with you, man. That's horrible.
I know, and you won't. But the thing I want to get to...
We did promise naked pictures of the Supreme
Court. Yeah, we did.
No.
Let's get to those.
Why
which
can't,
are in this book,
why
which
can't
is a
we
very
just
funny
talk?
Book.
Please, I beg of you guys.
I think you watch too much Crossfire. We're going to take a quick break.
No. Look,
no, hold
please.
On, Joe. We've got commercials.
Please.
Next,
okay. Please stop.
In the rapid fire.
Please.
Hopefully
stop.
He'll be here. We hope, we think. And then, did U.S. soldiers refuse an order in Iraq? Will Splitzer has the latest on this investigation right after the break.
I'm Wolf Blitzer in Washington. Coming up at the top of the hour, the Pentagon investigates a report that U.S. soldiers refused to go on a dangerous mission in Iraq. We'll have details. In medical news, the FDA prescribes a strongly worded label on antidepressant drugs. And why some experts think the flu vaccine shortage is a grim warning about U.S. vulnerability to bioterrorism. All those stories, much more, only minutes away on Wolf Blitzer Reports. Now back to Crossfire.
Welcome back to Crossfire. We're talking to John Stewart, who was just lecturing us on our moral inferiority. John, you're bumming us out. Tell us, what do you think of the Bill O'Reilly vibrator story?
No.
I'm sorry? I don't.
Oh, okay.
What do you think?
Let me change the subject then.
Where's your moral outrage on this?
I don't have any.
I know.
Which candidate do you suppose would provide you better material?
I'm sorry?
Which candidate do you suppose would provide you better material if he won?
Mr. T. I think he'd be the funniest.
Would you have a stake in it that way, as not just a citizen, but as a professional comic?
Right, which I hold to be much more important than as a citizen.
Well, there you go. Who would provide you better material, do you suppose?
I don't really know. It's kind of not how we look at it. We look at the absurdity of the system provides us the most material, and that is best served by sort of the theater of it all, you know, which, by the way, thank you both, because it's been helped.
But if Kerry gets elected, is it good? I mean, you said you're voting for him. You obviously support him. It's clear. Will it be harder for you to mock his administration if he becomes president?
Now, why would it be harder?
Because you
the only way it would be harder is if his administration is less absurd than this one. So in that case, if it's less absurd, then yeah, I think it'd be harder. But, I mean, it'd be hard to top this group. I mean, quite frankly, in terms of absurdity and their world matching up to the one that, you know, it was interesting. President Bush was saying, you know, John Kerry, his rhetoric doesn't match his record. But I've heard President Bush describe his record. His record doesn't match his record. So, you know, I don't worry about it in that respect. But let me ask you guys again a question, because we talked a little bit about, you know, you're actually doing honest debate and all that. But after the debates, where do you guys head to right afterwards?
The men's room.
Right after that.
Right, home.
Spin Alley.
Home?
No, Spin Alley.
What are you talking about? I mean, at these debates?
Yeah, you go to Spin Alley, the place called Spin Alley.
Mm-hmm.
Now, don't you think that for people watching at home, that's kind of a drag, that you're literally walking to a place called Deception Lane? Like, it's Spin Alley. It's don't you see that's the issue I'm trying to talk to you guys?
No, I actually believe, I had a lot of friends who worked for President Bush.
Mm-hmm.
I went to college with
neither someone. Of us was ever in the spin room, actually.
I did. I went to the Larry King show. They actually believe what right. they're saying. They want to persuade you. That's what they're trying to do by spinning. But I don't doubt for a minute these people who work for President Bush, who I disagree with and everything, they
right.
believe that stuff, John. This is not
here's
a
what
lie
I think.
Or deception at all.
I think
they
believe
in him.
I think they believe.
Just like I believe in my guys.
I think they believe President Bush would do a better job. And I believe the Kerry guys believe President Kerry would do a better job. But what I believe is they're not making honest arguments. So what they're doing is, in their mind, the ends justify
John,
the means.
I hate
so at all.
I do think you're more fun on your show. Just my opinion.
But
John Stewart goes one on one with his fans.
You're as big a dick on your show as you are on any show.
Now you're getting into it. I like that.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll be right back.
Eastern.
Welcome back to Crossfire. We are joined by Comedy Central's Jon Stewart, host of The Daily Show, and author of number one bestseller, America the Book, A Citizen's Guide
and
to Democracy in Action. Some questions from our audience. Yes, sir, what's your name?
David. I'm from Boston.
Hi, David.
My question is, what do you think the hump on GW's back during the debate was?
Say it again?
What do you think the hump on George's back during the debate was?
The hump on his back?
Oh, you're not familiar? This is a conspiracy theory. Can I take this one?
Yeah, please.
It was nothing. His suit was puckering. A lot of people believe he had one of these in his ear. If he was being fed lines by Karl Rove, he would not have been so inarticulate, guys. It's a myth. It's not true. There's this huge myth out on the left about this.
Mr. Jon Stewart.
Yes, ma'am.
Renee from Texas. Why do you think it's hard or difficult or impossible for politicians to answer a straight, simple question?
I don't think it's hard. I just think that nobody holds their feet to the fire to do it, so they don't have to. They get to come on, you know, shows that don't...
Well, they're too easy on them?
Yeah.
Not
ask
easy
how
on
you
them.
Holding
you
up
began
and stuff
by
like
saying
that.
We were too hard on people and too right. difficult or contentious. And that,
I think you're... Yeah.
All right, Jon Stewart, come back soon!
That's inconsistent. Jon Stewart, good of you to join us. Thank you very much. The book is America, A Citizen's Guide to Democracy in Action. From the left, I am Paul Begala. That's it for
And
Friday.
From the right, I'm Tucker Carlson. Have a great weekend. See you Monday.
Oh, that went great.
Happening now, an extraordinary